everyone. This is Amanda from devotioninaction.com, and we're here with our Rosie the Riveter printable, and I'm going to use the largest one on the second page of printables, and I'm going to put it behind this text, but so that her face shows through this opening that happens in between the text, where there's like a verse that's quoting another book, that it creates like this opening in the text, using some washi tape that I've already tapped on my fingers, used before, to connect these two pages together. And we're going to trace out Rosie the Riveter. Now, like I said, we're in 2 Timothy 2. I'm having quite a bit of trouble with the the entry that I already have on the back side of this page, seeing the lines of the printable. It's pretty difficult. Gonna have to use light underneath it, and even at some points just looking at the printable and redrawing on top of the page, just because it was just really hard to see with all of the lines of the other entry that I have on the back side of this page. So you might see me struggle a bit with this tracing. But our key verse in this chapter is verse 15. Do your best to present yourself to God as one approved, a worker who has no need to be ashamed, rightly handling the word of truth. So where I got this printable from is during World War II, the American government rolled out what became possibly the most successful ad campaign in history. Some people say it is the absolute most successful one in history. The centerpiece of this ad campaign was a character named Rosie the Riveter. There were print ads and even a song calling the women of this country to step up and join the workforce. The men were fighting overseas, and factories and manufacturing plants had employee shortages that were crippling the military effort and everyday life here at home. And women answered the call and filled the empty spaces, building planes, cars, processing food, and much more. This willing worker attitude stemmed from an ability to see purpose in the changes it would bring to their lives. 2 Timothy chapter 2 also talks about willing workers. So we start off this chapter in verses 1 through 7. You then, my child, be strengthened by the grace that is in Christ Jesus. And what you have heard from me in the presence of many witnesses, entrust to faithful men, who will be able to teach others also. Share in the suffering as a good soldier of Christ Jesus. No soldier gets entangled in civilian pursuits, since his aim is to please the one who enlisted him. An athlete is not crowned unless he competes according to the rules. It is the hard-working farmer who ought to have the first share of the crops. Think over what I say, for the Lord will give you understanding in everything. So this opening to chapter 2 talks about a good soldier, a good athlete, and a hard-working farmer, and how their work ethic, their attitude, entitles them to some blessings, right? They get crowned, like, if as the athlete, if they compete according to the rules and they're achieving, like, they can't win unless they do that. The hardworking farmer should have the first share of the crops. Okay, it's talking about this work ethic, this attitude. What attitude are we going to have as we work in life? Just a reminder. The work that God calls us to is not through our own strength. So this isn't about putting a ton of pressure on ourselves to do it all ourselves. We don't have to muscle through life. We are strengthened by the grace that is in Christ Jesus. God calls us, He empowers us, and gives us direction for how we are to accomplish His purposes. We just have to be willing, like Rosie the Riveter here. So let's remember who he is. We're going on in the chapter. This is verses 8 through 13. Remember Jesus Christ, risen from the dead, the offspring of David, as preached in my gospel, for which I am suffering, bound with chains as a criminal. But the word of God is not bound. Therefore I endure everything for the sake of the elect, that they also may obtain the salvation that is in Christ Jesus with eternal glory. This saying is trustworthy, for if we have died with him, we will also live with him. If we endure, we will also reign with him. If we deny him, he will deny us. If we are faithless, he remains faithful, for he cannot deny himself. So we can tap into the power of Jesus' resurrection. He's all-powerful and always faithful. His word is not tied up and restricted, but is powerful, living, and active. And we go on, verses 14 through 21. Remind them of these things and charge them before God not to quarrel about words, which does no good, but only ruins the hearers. Do your best to present yourself to God as one approved, a worker who has no need to be ashamed, rightly handling the word of truth. But avoid irreverent babble, for it will lead people into more and more ungodliness, and their talk will spread like gangrene. Among them are Hymenaeus and Philetus, who have swerved from the truth, saying that the resurrection has already happened. They are upsetting the faith of some, but God's firm foundation stands, bearing this seal. The Lord knows those who are his, and let everyone who names the name of the Lord depart from iniquity. Now in a great house, there are not only vessels of gold and silver, but also of wood and clay, for some for honorable use and some for dishonorable. Therefore, if anyone cleanses himself from what is dishonorable, he will be a vessel for honorable use, set apart as holy, useful to the master of the house, and ready for every good work. God created us for a purpose. Our job is to present ourselves as workers who are willing to do what he tells us. Sometimes we spend all our time talking about what God says or arguing with unbelievers on social media. This passage reminds us that God is calling us to be devotion in action, not in argument. 2 Timothy 2:22 through 26. So flee youthful passions and pursue righteousness, faith, love, and peace, along with those who call on the Lord from a pure heart. Have nothing to do with foolish, ignorant controversies. You know that they breed quarrels. And the Lord's servant must not be quarrelsome, but kind to everyone, able to teach, patiently enduring evil, correcting his opponents with gentleness. God may perhaps grant them repentance, leading to a knowledge of the truth, that they may come to their senses and escape the snare of the devil after being captured by him to do his will. Being kind to everyone. That alone could make most of us repent and drop to our knees. Do I approach others with gentleness and truth? Do we present ourselves to God as willing workers with pure hearts? Or maybe you see what God wants you to do and you're like, well, I like so-and-so's job better. Couldn't I do that, God? Maybe we're arguing with God about what he wants us to do, what his purpose is for us. 2 Timothy 2 challenges us to a life of devotion to God that springs into action at his command. We work for his kingdom, no matter what our occupation is. Now, I'm not talking about everyone needs to become a pastor of a church. Everyone needs to become a worship leader or a full-time ministry position. I'm saying that no matter what our occupation is, we work for his kingdom. We step out of our comfort zones, like the women who responded to the Rosie the Riveter ad campaign, and get to work in God's kingdom. So our action step this week is pretty simple. I'm going to pause for just a second before I tell you the action step. I have got my Faber-Castell Pitt Artist pen here, and I'm just tracing out these lines in her face with that pen. This page was a little bumpy, and I don't know if it's from the entry that's on the back side of the page, or because my matte gel medium that I use to prep the page is getting old and I need to buy another jar of it. But my pen like bumped in what would be on my, like looking at the screen, my right, the Rosie the Riveter's left eye. So it is wonky and turned out really kind of weird. The pen kind of bumped and I got really dark black on that eye. turned out not super happy. I'm way happier with the drawing I did for the principal than I am with how it turned out on the page of the Bible. But I have to remind myself that the purpose of Bible art journaling is not perfect art or beautiful art. The purpose of Bible art journaling is to reflect on the Word of God, and for me to become the masterpiece, for God to work in me, for His Word to come to life, for me to remember and to put into practice, to put into action what God's Word says. So even though her face came out looking a little funky, to use a technical term, a little strange, and weird, that's not, it's not the point of Bible art journaling to be perfect. The point is that we go through the process of creatively responding to God's Word, go through the process of doing it while we're meditating on His Word, so that God can transform us into His masterpiece. So just a little side note there for those of you who sometimes create your art and you don't like how it turned out, you don't like, you know, what you know, what's happening there, or maybe you feel like you're not to the level of being an artist that you would like to be. I'm certainly in that space a lot of the time. That's not the main goal of Bible art journaling. Bible art journaling, though I'm sure we do become better artists as we do it routinely and consistently, that's not the goal. The goal is to become closer to God and more like Jesus as we go through this process. So just a reminder of what the important stuff is, both to myself as I look at this entry and I'm not super, super happy with it, and for you. So our action step is, are you a willing worker? Sometimes I look around and I want other people's assignments. I want God to call me to something different because I feel like I'm not good enough or I feel uncomfortable doing it. I need to present myself as a willing worker, ready to jump into action rather than arguing with others. So, and we're about to get started watercoloring. So I'm going to go ahead and pray for all of us. Dear God, help us not to spend our lives on empty words and arguments, but to present ourselves as willing workers to do your will. Give us courage to step out of our comfort zones and into your power. In our weakness, show your strength. In Jesus' name, amen. So as we go into watercoloring our Rosie the Riveter, we're going to grab, like, I use like a kind of a gold with some pinky coral undertones, matches my skin tone. So she might have a bit more of a tan than I do. Seriously, guys, I've got like copy paper skin, like just white, very, very white skin. Get lay down like a light color of that skin tone, and then I'll come back and create kind of the contours and the shadows with a little bit darker version of this. So I gotta get that on her hands, her arms, and I did not make enough of it, so we're gonna go back and grab some more of that, pull in some of that corally color that I've already got mixed down the bottom of my palette, and just get that light color down on the page. If you notice on the arms, you're gonna want to pull a little bit darker where it's closest to the shirt, where the other arm overlaps the bottom arm, on the bottoms of the arms, and in like the crook of the arm, where the two arms meet. That's where we would see a lot of shadowing would be, in those places. In the hand, the same thing. Think about where it would fold over on itself and create a shadow. So now we're coming in with that little bit of darker and a little bitty brush, because this is a pretty small image, and adding in those shadows, kind of around the eye and the nose, on the back side of the face, wherever I'm picturing kind of that shadow coming from a light source. Um, and this is really kind of personal preference, the thing is to picture where the light is coming from and where your shadows are going to be. Okay, like is her face kind of turned away from maybe the flash of a camera that she's flexing for, you know, kind of thing. So that is, that's like a personal preference. You could create the shadow on the opposite side of the face from what I did and think like the light from the fire is actually like having the pictures interact with one another. I've been thinking about these as kind of independent entries on the same page. And so I wasn't thinking about that when I did it, but that might be pretty cool if you wanted to, create your shadowing so that it's like she's by the fire and the back side of her face is being lit by the fire and the front side would have the shadow. It's just about being consistent, where you put the shadowing as far as like where your light source is. And then I want to come in with kind of a black. It's not going to be completely black. I'm going to leave a little bit of white space there because I want her hair to be like black hair, but I also want to be able to see that there is some contour in that. So picture glossy black hair that's reflecting some light and there's some white reflecting and bouncing off of that. That's what I've got going on here. So her hair, and then she also has this head wrap that's red, and so pulling in some of that red and creating the right color there for the head wrap that's going to be red. Now in the ad, in the print ad, this is red with white polka dots. You are welcome to do the white polka dots if you would like. That seemed like a bit more work than I was willing to do on this entry, because polka dots get a little bit tricky with watercolor because of the way that it flows around, because you have to leave the white space. I guess you could do it red and then come back in with, like, after it dries, with a white gel pen and create them that way if you want those polka dots on there. That would be a pretty easy way to incorporate the polka dots. So if you just Google an image of Rosie the Riveter, you'll see like she has white polka dots on a red like hair scarf, head scarf. And then I had no idea, guys. I looked up at one point, I was like, oh crud, my camera went off at some point. It just like turned itself off and the battery was not dead. I don't know. It was crazy. So you'll notice that on her shirt, in those creases on the bottom parts of the shirt, it's darker. That's the shadowing that I did there. Add in some fingernail polish to match her headscarf and her lipstick. I'm so sorry about the missing content. It's just, I didn't realize that my camera turned off, so I apologize for that. But the blue of the shirt is not that bad. I added some gray in to a bright blue to give kind of a denim look or uniform blue look to that. And this is basically the entry. Thank you so much for watching, and I'll see you in 2 Timothy 3 next week.